Turning to number 302, the hardback hymnal, 302. Let's sing the first and the last verse of this one. On our prayer list this tonight, we've been asked to remember Maddie Wheat, Ryan McGuire, Logan Mullins, Lonnie Fieldback, Ivan Mink, Diana Bennett, Bandy Meese, Carla Wilson, Heather Brooks, and the family of Vicki Lakes Barnes, and I continue to remember the family of Benny Cromer and April Cromer McGuire too. So let's remember those in our prayers tonight. Number 302.
Oh, the depth and the riches of God's saving grace, flowing down from the cross for me. There the debt for my sins by the Savior was paid in his suffering on Calvary.
see everyone that's made it out tonight. It's another little chilly night, but we're fortunate to be able to come gather together in comfort of building and look at another piece of scripture, study what the word of the Lord has for us. We'll go back to our study in Revelation. We had covered last time, it's been a few weeks ago, but covered the first 8-10 verses there. So we want to take up where we left off. Let's go back to verse 7 and begin with our text and reading tonight. We had talked about the final judgment that's coming, and John's going to be writing about now, and the overthrow of Satan and Satan's reign ending. So we see that this great deceiver from the very beginning of time, we're finding out now as John writes and looks toward the future of what's happening and the final end of Satan and all of his allies. So his reign on earth, where he's loosed for a while, you know, he's gathering all the souls he can to be with him and turn away from the Lord. And, you know, we find even Jesus saying, looking into the future, you know, few that's going to be remaining that are faithful and true to the Lord and his word, and many are going to be on the wide road to destruction. But let's begin in verse 7, and we find there John writing of Satan's rebellion that's now crushed. It says, "Now when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. They went upon the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are. And they will be tormented day and night forever and forever." So with this reading on our mind, we've got much to be thankful for tonight. Let's humble ourselves in some manner while the one selected leads our mind.
Time, let's pray. Your most gracious Heavenly Father, we will thank you for this another opportunity we have to come out to your house to worship you in the spirit and the truth. Heavenly Father, we pray for the church, that it would always shine as a bright light on a hill and never be hid, where the world could see it and want to know more about it, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we pray for your word, which is a lamp unto our feet, light unto our path, which is our roadmap from earth to heaven. And we pray that we would study it, show ourselves approved, and become working right and dividing the word of truth, before we would be able to give an answer to anyone who would ask us of the hope that is within us, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we pray for the widows and the orphans, that we would assist them in a way to be pleasing with thee. We pray for the ones that are bringing up children, that they'd bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, that when they grow old, they might not turn from it, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we pray for the sick. We pray for all the ones that have listed their names on the prayer list and others around the community, for loved ones that are in hospitals, homesick beds, nursing homes, wherever they may be, Heavenly Father, realizing that you are the great healer of all diseases, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we pray if there's one or more here tonight that's never obeyed the gospel, that it would, for it's everlasting and eternally too late. Or if there's one or more here that has obeyed it, but has turned from it, they'd come back making things right with you, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we pray for those that have lost loved ones, that you would comfort them and say our sorrow, Heavenly Father, in the way that you know how. Heavenly Father, we pray for the one that does the teaching here, that they would teach your word boldly, where we'd be able to follow along to see if what's being taught is the truth, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we pray for the sunshine, the rain, the fruitful season. We thank you for the air that we breathe and the water that we drink. And Heavenly Father, we ask you to be with us throughout our lives. If we ain't faithful, we could all have a home with you in heaven. In Jesus' blessed holy name.
Invitation hymn will be number 593. I was reminded that I failed to mention the chapter. We're in chapter 20, in case anybody ever wondered. So we'll continue there in chapter 20, beginning in verse 7 tonight. And this is a very interesting part of the study Revelations. You know, we had studied a lot of different things and what was going on and what was going on in the past. A lot of the history pointed back, you know, to the Old Testament and things that was happening then under the old law. And of course, John writes about the present, his present time, when many of the early New Testament Christians are under such great persecution under Rome. And this, of course, was one of Satan's allies. And just as he talks about, you know, the false beast and the false prophet. So in these last few chapters now, John's turning his attention and talking more about the future and what's going to happen, the end of time and the last judgment, the second coming of Christ. And as all through the book, of course, he's writing to these early New Testament Christians and indeed for us to study and learn and use for encouragement to understand that to get this writing and everything back to all of these Christians, he used all of these symbols that sometimes confuses us. And is often used to construe, you know, to what some men will think instead of what is the spiritual message for us. But we see here that Satan, who had been deceiving from the very beginning, we see now he's going to reach his final doom and his eternal end, and all of his allies that he's had working with him. And of course, when he loses the authority of this Roman Empire, when it was overthrown, you know, he's loosed and he just goes about and finds other methods. Just as Christ said, is like a lion roaming about seeking whom he may devour. He wants each and every one of us, all of our souls. So he talks here again, as we had talked about last time, this 1,000 years, and a lot of times that gets all of the attention of this particular section of Revelation. Some have said, you know, that this is a literal 1,000 years, and they bring in the rapture and all of these other theories that are not part of the truth of the Bible, the authority with which he's speaking. But he's talking in symbols again, just as a lot of time, a lot of years, or a lot of time expired. And, you know, it's hard for us to understand, but God said, you know, one day is 1,000 years. You can't comprehend that. 1,000 years is as one day with him. So it's hard to begin to rationalize without time. And, you know, this is one of the joys of heaven, as John writes here and speaks of no more death. You know, ever since we've been born and matured, grow up, you know, we've all seen death. We've seen older, perhaps, relatives. We've seen friends. As we age and get older and weaker, we've seen brothers and sisters in Christ, friends, family members pass on. And that's a normal part of life here on earth. But we can take great encouragement. After we reach our eternal home in heaven, there's no more death, no more aging, no more sorrow, no more pain, no more crying. We don't need any sun or the moon for the light. Christ is going to be the light forever and ever and ever without end. So this is one of the main themes of John's message as he writes the whole book here. Give encouragement to Christians and those under persecution. So he talks here of Satan being released for a while, and he's deceiving the nations which are in the four corners of the earth. And Christ has said, and of course Satan is forever deceiving right now, trying to gain more and more from the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog. This is kind of confusing. We try to figure out what that meaning is, but again, it goes back to an area, and there's been a lot written about a specific area or country. It's merely referring to the area, and this is generally, it was first spoken of the prophet Ezekiel. All of Ezekiel, the 38th chapter, goes into a great detail of this, and the end as he's prophesying, and this is generally the area of all of Europe and Asia Minor, and covers these peoples and this land. And he's saying to gather them together to battle, and whose number is the sand of the sea. So it's really all of mankind that Satan's deceiving all of these years. He's wanting to gain more and more over to his side, or convince people just to be lukewarm. They don't have to fight for him and try to draw other people aside. They just ignore the Lord and live for a day. You know, if he can do that, he's won them over to his side. And that's one of the greatest downfalls, I think, of many of mankind. They're perform for the Lord. They may believe in the Lord. They may even believe Jesus is Christ, is the Son of God. They may not take that next step and accept Him as their Savior. And take that next step to obey. Be baptized for the remission of our sins. This is the complete circle of faith. We have to listen to and obey to be acceptable unto Him and to inherit our eternal home. So he said, verse 9, they went out on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints of the beloved city. They surrounded the camp of the saints. And again, symbolically here, again, he's just referring to God's people. He's referring to the church and faithful Christians. And John's talking about, since he's brought, these other people, these other areas, Gog and Magog, into his judgment, all of mankind, as the sands of the sea, are going to be judged at the end of time in judgment. And there's so much, reference and you could go to and look at as the end of time we've been talking about, and judgment. Judgment is a whole new lesson as we look at Matthew, the 24th chapter, and other scriptures, as we see all are going to give an account of their lives to Christ on the day of judgment, and all will be separated on the left and the right, the sheep and the goats, he talks about. So the camp of the saints, he's talking about there, the bride, the church, and those who are remaining faithful. And this great Satan, this great deceiver, we see he's going to reach his final doom. We find, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are. We've talked at length about the beast and the false prophet. They're judged now with Satan, and all are going to be condemned to the lake of fire and brimstone. And they will be tormented day and night forever and forever. So we see here again, this was talked about in several previous chapters that we've looked at. Chapter 12, it talked about Satan going to be cast down, and just back over in the very first of this chapter 20, and we find now Satan is, and he's talking about the future here, what's going to happen at the end. Satan will be reach his ultimate end and destruction. So we find back Matthew 25 and 41. It says, again, Christ talking of judgment. He says, then shall he say unto them on the left, depart from me, ye cursed, and the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Hell was prepared for the devil and his angels to start with. Those who rebelled, those who took up sides with Satan, that's what hell was prepared for. And Satan now shares this eternal judgment with all of his allies, those that have worked with him, the beast, the false prophet, and the harlot that we talked about in several chapters. So now they're all of his allies are judged and will be condemned for forever and forever. So John had talked previously in chapter 7, before the throne of God. In chapter 14, he talked about this torment and said, the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, in Revelation 14 and 11. So We find now as we look at verse 11, John writes there and talks about now pointing to the final judgment. He says, I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. So we see here now John, of course, being led in spirit. He's seeing these events of the future that are going to happen. And he's writing, he's leaving those words for us as best as he can describe here. This study, you know, we've been looking at so far has been several scenes that John has described. He begins verse 11 here again, then I saw. So he's being led in spirit. And in spirit, he's having a vision. He's, you know, we think of actually physically, literally being there watching what's going on. Of course, John is in spirit. And in spirit, he's seeing these visions of what is coming and what's going to happen. So we see here of all of these visions so far, none of them have been of this final judgment. There was a judgment of the nations, talked about being judged back in chapter 11, and it talked about those, the saints, you know, that he saw were crying out for justice, that had been persecuted, had been put to death, were crying out from the throne for, you know, God's mercy on those that were being tormented so long. And that was a lot of the chapter 16 we looked at. Another one of John's visions. And again, one of the harlot in chapter 18, and the beast and the false prophet we just studied about in chapter 19. These are visions that he's seeing, and where they're ending up, the end of time, toward the end. They're on that road to destruction. But now he's talking about the final judgment and before the throne, an eternal destiny being determined. So, you know, these false prophet and the beast, you know, those were all referring to this present time John was writing of Rome and those evil Roman emperors that persecuted the Christians so much. But now he's talking more, he's looking toward the future, and the future that he's talking about and the judgment that is to come. So, you know, God, we find Jesus is going to be the judge, and the forces of weakness and wickedness and the forces of evil that have aligned with Satan, their eternity is determined now. They receive this final death sentence and the final judgment. All, as he symbolically refers to as the sands of the sea, all are going to receive their final sentence, whether it be eternal life or whether it be eternal death. Those who have remained faithful unto the end, death will, as Paul described it, will have no sting, have no power over them. They'll not taste the second death, but they will inherit eternal life in heaven with Christ. So, you know, John says here as he began verse 11, I saw, and being in spirit, he sees this great throne of judgment and the throne of God. And it's the greatest, in comparison to all the other thrones that's mentioned so far in John's writing in the book. And of course, white is mentioned here time and time again, indicating symbolically of purity and holiness and righteousness. So we find several New Testament scriptures that all refer back to exactly what John's talking about. John 5:22, he writes there, says, the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son. And on down in verse 30, John 5:30 says, I can of mine own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge. And my judgment is just, because I seek not mine own will, but the will of the Father which hath sent me. So once this judgment is made, there's no appeals. There's no appeal to a superior court. There's no appeal to the Supreme Court. He is the Supreme Court, and he's the ultimate. He's the final one. Once judgment has been netted down, there's no changing. Just as we learned in the parable of the rich man and Lazarus, the rich man lived sumptuously while on earth, and Lazarus suffered in pain. But we find such a vast difference after death. Lazarus awoke in paradise in Abraham's bosom and comforted. And this rich man was tormented with flames. He didn't ask for a retrial, reappealed. He asked for just a dip of Lazarus' tongue and finger in water that he could soothe his tongue. But it's too late. His time of opportunity had stopped. And we're all going to face that time, either our death or when Christ comes again. We will receive our final judgment, our final sentence. So the explanation we can find in various references all throughout the New Testament of judgment is offered by Paul in many of his letters to the churches that he helped to establish. He told the Romans in Romans 2:16, he said, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ, according to my gospel. So we are not going to be judged by the old law of Moses that's been put away. We'll be judged by the new covenant, the New Testament church. And we'll be judged by Christ's commands and what he's told us to do, how he's told us to be saved, obeying the plan of salvation, repenting of our sins, baptized for the remission of our sins, the right baptism, that we can follow his commands exactly as he's told us. We find the Old Testament, Psalms 102:25. David wrote there, of old hast thou laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are works of thy hand. They shall perish, but thou shalt endure. Yea, all of them shall wax old like a garment. But we know God's word, his word, is going to endure. We talked about signs of the end of time and all of the change that's taken place in all areas of our life, of increased communications and so many changes we face, technology, and and our lives are going to be changed, you know, even in the next few years, the next 5 or the next 10 years. We can't imagine what change is going to affect us. But one thing we know for sure, God's word is the same now and forever. And it'll be the same till Christ come back. Those same commands, that same plan of salvation will be right there, and it will not waver. It can't be voted on by a conference that says, you know, this is all right, even though the Bible says it's not. You know, that's going on. We've got to hold fast to what's true and what's never changing in God's word and his commands for us. Again, Peter said, 2 Peter 3:10, he said, the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. So again, you know, we're told, what would it profit us if we had gained the whole world, our labor, had amassed all of the fortunes, all of the assets, the land, all that was in the earth? What would it profit us if on the day of judgment we lost our soul, if we received the sentence of eternal damnation? We would give all the riches of the earth over and over again, just as the parable of the rich man. We would give all of the riches of the earth over and over again if we had that sentence and we somehow could change it. So today is why we're mentioned. Today's the day of salvation. Today we've got opportunity till Christ comes again. On down in verse 12, John goes on and writes, and I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were opened. Another book was opened, which is a book of life, and the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, each one according to his works. So, you know, we see here that we look back at a lot of the history and of the Jews, and they, looking at their culture, they placed a great deal of emphasis on the burial of the dead and burying the dead quickly. There's a great fear if this exact ritual wasn't followed. So, it's interesting to note as we look at what John writes here, and he talked about the dead, small and great, standing before God, and he talks about the sea giving up the dead who were in it. And you know, it's custom at sea, out on a ship, especially fishermen at that time was on a ship in the sea, they would be buried at sea, and they would be wrapped and thrown overboard. So, you know, this was a common practice. The sea gave up the dead that was in it, and literally, you know, we know of many ships and various storms and all that have sunk and taken many people to the bottom of the sea. We see very common in World War II is a lot of troop ships were on the way to Europe. The Germans torpedoed and a lot of lives were lost there. So he's referring to the sea is holding a great deal of dead. see this, and you know, and many times these physical bodies are not recovered. There's still many soldiers that bodies have never been recovered from World War II, from Korea, from Vietnam. So what John's writing about, you know, these are not just lost souls forever. All of these are coming forth on the day of judgment, and all who have died since the beginning of time are all going to be judged. So regardless of the final resting place of everyone on the face of the earth, these are going to come forth, and they're going to be before the throne of God and be judged. So all of mankind, none is going to escape. And we've read several times of the scripture in Thessalonians, and 1 Thessalonians 4 and 13. You know, Paul talked to the Thessalonians. They were concerned about those that had died and passed on before, and especially those that bodies perhaps wasn't recovered. And that's a whole section that's interesting as we read. We won't go to that tonight, but Paul is telling the Thessalonians, you know, be assured that, you know, you won't come before them. Those that have gone on, they're going to be raised. You'll see them again. They'll be, you know, even as you're known. And, you know, they won't prevent or won't come before. They won't be lost forever. So, again, he says there, everyone will be judged according to their works. And, you know, this same thought is projected all the way back in the Old Testament. The prophets relayed the same message. Even Ecclesiastes, the 12th chapter of Ecclesiastes, verse 14 says, God shall bring every work unto judgment, with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. So, men have tried to hide things on earth. You know, there's many murders in this country that go unsolved, that they never find the murderer. But you know, all of these things God knows. Even the hairs of our head are numbered. These things are all going to be brought forth. All that we've said, all that we've done will come forth to Christ in judgment. So we see then, as we go on, the sea gave up the dead in it, death and hell delivered up the dead that were in them, and they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So we see that if we have lived faithfully here on earth, if we have done all that's in our power to obey Christ's commands, if we have obeyed his plan of salvation, if we've worshiped, pleading, what's pleasing unto him. You know, if we're found faithful, we'll be given that sentence of eternal life. So we've got hell mentioned several times in Revelation with death. Really all through Revelation, the sixth chapter, and John symbolically talked about these horsemen, pale horse. His name that said on him was death and hell, and these rode together as as allies of Satan, drawing faithful aside. So death is the last enemy that's going to be destroyed. The last enemy of Christ that's going to be overcome. As Paul told the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 15 and 25, he says, "For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet." And the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. It's the last enemy that shall be destroyed. So the second death, described as a lake of fire, John mentioned that earlier in the second chapter. "He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death." This is what he's talking about. So all those that were not found written in the book of life are going to be destroyed, are going to be sentenced to this lake of fire and brimstone. John wrote in the third chapter of Revelation, "I know thy works, whether thou art neither cold nor hot." He's talking to one group, the churches here. "Would that thou were cold or hot. So because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I'll spew thee out of my mouth." So we see in closing this 20th chapter, John is encouraging all of these Christians to persevere, to hold on. He knows from the Word of God that the great persecution will let up, will come to an end. The false prophet, the beast, the Roman emperors will be overthrown, and the word of the Lord goes out from these few men that received that great commission and went out all to the all known world at that time. And even under great suppression, you know, it continued to flourish. So our lesson, you know, we can learn from all of this is we too must persevere. We're being tested. We're being told it, you know, in cases, laws are being passed that are contrary to the Lord's laws and his commands. And as we've said before, we're living in perilous times. So things will probably get worse. But as Christians, we've got to hold true to our faith and endure to the end. And then we too can inherit our crown of eternal life. We have another opportunity tonight. Not accepted Christ as your Savior, you're baptized for the remission of sins. You do that, or you have strayed for one reason or another, we were told to just confess that and pray that we may be headed back to the fold. If we want to be the case, would you come as we stand and sing this invitation?
There's a fountain free, 'tis for you and me. Let us haste, oh, haste to the brink. 'Tis a fountain of love.
thank you for your great attention tonight. This study can sometimes wear on us. It's sometimes hard to understand, but I think the more we look and study and go over it, we can understand it a little better and help encourage us too, just as John was writing to early New Testament Christians. Just remember our service this Sunday. Article paper should come out tomorrow. Do be folding. Remember all the sick prayers. Any other message? Answer? If not, you'll be dismissed. Lord, pray.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this time you've allowed us to come at your house, worship you in spirit and truth, sing songs, praise your holy name, and do another great lesson from your word. We thank you, God, for all the blessings you give us, all things you do for us. We pray as we leave here that we'll remember our work is never over. We do all we can do for your cause, work each day, tell others about you. We pray that we'll have our name written in that book of life when things are over. Pray that we'll remember the sick, be with them, ask you to be with them, and restore their health back to them. We'll remember the ones, lost loved ones, in their prayers. Be with them and comfort them. Watch over us and keep us safe. See that us home safely. And we pray that we'll be back here at your house first day of the week. This is our prayer. In Christ's name we pray.